I'm Rick Yost. I'm a professor of chemistry at the University of Florida.
My name is Chris Enke, and I'm currently retired. I'm emeritus from Michigan State University and from the University of New Mexico.
When I was a graduate student and Chris and I came up with the crazy idea of building a triple quadrupole mass spectrometer for doing analytical tandem mass spectrometry, it's pretty clear that it was very different than what anyone else thought would work. It's pretty clear the reviewers of the proposal that we wrote were convinced that it would never work.
The way this all came about included a wonderful bit of serendipity. I had switched from being an electrochemist in my main research into developing computer-based instrumentation. And I had an idea that it would be wonderful for, since the computer could now control the instrument, if the computer would do that very smartly.
But in this case, the idea of using mass spectrometry to both separate components and analyze them, and to do this all under computer control. We talked about it as the ultimate computer-controlled analytical instrument, or as I like to think about it, the ultimate instrumentalization of a computer.
In order to do chemical analysis, we needed a method of separation, and then we need a method of identification. And in order to bring both of those under computer control, the information from the separation, or the instruction to separate and the instruction to identify, needed to be instantly accessible. So that kept us from using chromatography for separation. One night, coming back from a fax conference late at night, Rick was keeping me awake by choosing to discuss how we might solve this problem. And he had had some experience with quadrupole mass spectrometers, and he said that would be a good way to make a separation that's instantly available. And that sounded good. And then the question was, well, then what would we use for identification? Well, mass spectrometry is really good for identification too, so maybe another quadrupole would be nice for identifying. Well, you don't get any new information if you just put two quadrupoles together. Something has to happen in between. And the thing that has to happen in between is the selected ion that you've mass selected to get your sample from your sample needs to be fragmented. So we were looking for a method of fragmentation. It was well known at that time that in order to collisionally fragment an ion, you needed thousands of electron volts of kinetic energy before that ion colliding into something would actually fragment. That was widely believed to be the case. And even so, it wasn't very efficient. The other possibility that we looked into was electron impact of the selected ions, and that wasn't going to be very efficient either. We went to a mass spectrometry meeting, my first, Rick's second, in Washington, D.C. And there I noticed as one of the attendants an old friend, Jim Morrison, that I had met years earlier.
We ran into Jim Morrison from La Trobe University in Australia at the mass spectrometry conference in 1977, described to him what we wanted to do. And I think he was the first mass spectrometrist we ever met who said it would work.
Well, he was studying photofragmentation. So he was interested in fragmentation. But he said, I'm afraid that's not going to work for you guys because it is really inefficient. It is so inefficient, he said, that the quadrupole I use for selecting the ion that I'm going to fragment and the quadrupole that I use for looking at the product mass, he said, when I turn on my laser, the difference that I get is so small, I'm having to use synchronous demodulation to sort the fragments that I was trying to get by photoionization from the noise. And I said, what noise? Because the only way he could have noise at his detector was to be producing fragment ions without the light.
The background he was seeing, even when the laser wasn't on, was exactly what we wanted to see.
That night, I realized that in order to pursue this Jim's fragmentation process that was his noise, actually, and that was our answer, that it would be good if Rick could go to Jim's lab and do it, study that part of the process.
So a serendipitous meeting, fortuitous meeting that led to an opportunity for me to go to Australia and try our experiments on an instrument that he had already built while we were still in the middle of building ours. So that kind of lucky coincidence to run into Morrison and learn about an instrument that he'd never published. We didn't know about what he was doing, and he clearly didn't know about what we were doing, but that provided an opportunity to really test our ideas and to move forward much faster than we would have done had we been working totally by ourselves.
The biggest contributing factor to the invention of the triple quadrupole mass spec was undoubtedly the process of low energy collisional dissociation within a focusing collision cell. That was what enabled really this process to be efficient enough to be analytically useful. The high energy collision process that was used had an efficiency of 1 or 2% just about at best. So relatively little of the precursor ion was actually fragmented, whereas eventually the low energy collision process, which Rick and I developed, was much, much higher. And now it's nearly 100%. It could, but even at its inception, was over 40%.
So I guess, you know, a good way to think about our predictions for what the triple quad mass spec would be useful for is to go back and look at the grant proposal that we wrote. And you know, we boldly said this would be the ultimate computerized analytical instrument designed to intelligently answer chemical questions, not just take data. Pretty innovative for its time. There was a lot of Chris Enke's vision about how analytical chemistry and instruments would be changed by modern computers and electronics. And we talked about two specific application areas that made sense to us. One was for structural elucidation of compounds, that now you could take an ion from the ion source, you would normally just get a mass spectrum of that ion, and you could knock it apart and get a mass spectrum of its fragment ion. So using MSMS for structural elucidation was an obvious application. And the second we predicted was the use of this for mixture analysis by using the first stage of mass analysis to separate components of a mixture, then fragment those ions as they would normally fragment at the ion source, and then get mass spectra of the individual components. And it turned out that both those turned out, you know, to be the what we do today. And so I guess we were fairly good predictors of the analytical utility of tandem mass spectrometry.
Well, without a doubt, the ability to do MSMS studies on biomolecules is the thing that has not only surprised me, because that was not possible at all when Rick and I were first experimenting with this, putting this instrument together. And the advent of electrospray as an ionization source has really opened up all the areas of proteomics and metabolomics and so on. And those areas themselves are astounding when you think about it.
I would say, you know, the biggest single area of impact on mankind of the triple quad would probably have to be identified as neonatal screening. So, you know, a number of years ago, 50 years ago, Bob Guthrie showed you could test children by taking a pinprick of blood shortly after birth and test them for a disease that we call PKU, phenylketonuria. And it was a single test, but for those rare children who were born with that disease, you could have them lead a successful life by controlling their diet. Today, every state in the country and most countries elsewhere in the world test children for tens to hundreds of inborn errors of metabolism, newborn diseases, neonatal testing like that. Currently, probably 10 million children a year are tested worldwide by tandem mass spectrometry, not for PKU alone, but for many diseases. And it's estimated that annually, that probably saves 10,000 children a year who now, by knowing that they've a rare inherited disease, that you can control their diet or treat them in other ways in order to be able to let them live a much longer life and a more comfortable life than they would otherwise. So I think it's hard to pick out any single other area of triple quadrupole mass spectrometry for which it's had as much impact on mankind as something as straightforward as testing newborn babies. So I think the both the vision that Chris Enke had, as well as his willingness to go well out on a limb in a brand new area, was something that was enabling and unfortunately not too common, even in academics, to be willing to go so far from your comfort zone. So that was key to the development of the triple quad, because people thought a lot about analytical chemistry and computers and had not thought about mass spectrometry. So we weren't kind of steeped in the folklore that told everyone else that it wouldn't work. There's some advantage of being an outsider, I think, in a discipline, and that's what Chris and I were outsiders.